Hi everyone, welcome to our first DDE talk. My name is Laura Johnston, Principal at William Buck Gold Coast.
And I'm Eric Fleming, Senior Manager at William Buck Gold Coast.
Today we are here to begin deconstructing the digital economy. So Eric, is e-commerce changing the way Australians do business?
There is definitely no denying e-commerce is transforming the way Australians do business. It is actually changing the way Australians do business with the whole world. And really, in our experience, many businesses dread the idea of jumping online and embracing digital interactions with their customers. And these are most of the time somehow convinced of the benefits of e-commerce, but not really willing to invest yet. Those that have dared to conquer the digital world are actually reporting astonishing returns on investments. And as a matter of fact, nowadays, going digital is no longer a strategic path. It is a necessity for most Australian businesses wanting to survive the next decade. Disruption is coming? Well, it's actually here. And businesses have to quickly adapt.
So, Eric, what do businesses have to do to adapt?
Well, they have to embrace the digital world and continuously perfect their online strategies. Now, user participation, network effects, and user-generated content are important pillars of a great e-commerce strategy. And our series of podcasts will dig into these strategies later on, so stay tuned. But to me, a good e-commerce strategy starts with a business' overall ability to analyze, manipulate, and use the data it collects and generates through its e-commerce platform. And that is often referred to as the big data analytics.
Interesting. So what is the big data?
Well, it's significantly large data sets that are stored and analyzed with the help of the latest technologies to provide meaningful insights to the business and help in their decision making. So really, e-commerce big data analytics is nothing but the process of collecting and analyzing online purchase activity. And yet, it can mean so much more for businesses. Using big data analytics, businesses can discover various critical pieces of information such as market trends, customers' preferences, and this can be used to significantly scale up activities and deliver great services or improve products to its customers.
So how would you recommend e-commerce operators to use this big data to improve their return on investment?
Well, Laura, I believe there are four pillars to a successful e-commerce strategy, and all of them involve the use of the big data. The first is effective customer service. Every business got to work on their customer service. And there's been a recent survey that really shows that businesses need to focus on reducing missed customers' communications. That's the biggest issue with online businesses. As a matter of fact, 75% of people who contact a company for customer support via social media expect a response within an hour. And a prompt response to a complaint on social media can actually increase customer advocacy by as much as 25%. And all of this needs to be done in real time. As the ability to connect data about customers and respond quickly to that is increasingly what separates successful brands from the rest of the pack. And the only way to do this efficiently with the volume of interactions occurring is by harnessing big data and treating it in real time. The second is what I call enhancing the pattern analysis. Big data analytics is a great way of understanding a customer's shopping behavior and predictive patterns that will make better business strategies overall. Customers' preferences, most popular product or service lines, any product that people are seeing multiple times but are actually not offered by your business, any spikes in demand, what time of the year do customers shop more, so on and so forth, can be assessed through big data analytics. And that's really important for businesses to embrace that. The third one would be the idea of being able to predict the future and incorporate that with any business and e-commerce business operations. It gives a business a greater depth in understanding their overall operations, and e-commerce will have the added advantage of flexibility in deciding the best ways for operational efficiency. Using the data will help every business to effectively manage their inventory, their supply chain, forecasting demand, their sales strategies, and last but not least, better pricing strategies. For many customers, the decision of whether or not something is worth purchasing comes down to the fact of a simple change in price. With quality data on hand, businesses are better equipped to know which pricing strategies will make the greatest impact on their customers and their bottom lines. The last pillar for me is a new concept of micro moments, and every e-commerce business needs to increase their focus on that area. Micro moments is actually the latest e-commerce trend. It's the idea that customers generally seek quick actions. They want to go, they want to know, they want to buy now. And they look at accessing all of that through their smartphones. For example, a recent Google survey revealed that 69% of people search for travel ideas during spare moments. 91% look up for information on their smartphones while in the middle of doing something else. And 82% consult their phones while they're standing in a store deciding which product to buy. Really, businesses must use these micro moments to foresee customers' tendencies and their action patterns. And obviously, the whole smartphone technologies will significantly play a big role in all of this. And when it comes to micro moments, businesses must be there, they must be useful, and they must be accountable. And by that, I mean that really, at first, customers want relevant and contextual information served online, and they want to keep things private. They also want online payments to not only be available and easy to use, they must be secure and safe. And big data analytics really will help in identifying fraud-related activities and any threats to its processes. It also helps in having various payments options in a centralized platform, hence making the payments process easy and convenient for customers. There are no alternatives. Businesses must show that they are customer-centric and take user data security and privacy seriously, and can only achieve this through data analytics. But really, all of this is about creating a unique and reliable experience so that the customers enjoy transacting with businesses and through a wider variety of channels.
Thanks, Eric. That was really informative. I think you're right. Every business really needs to take this into account. What do you think are the biggest e-commerce challenges from a tax perspective?
Well, we could converse for days about this. And by the time we finish, really, legislation would have changed and we'll have to start all over again. This is rapidly evolving and there's still a lot of uncertainties. But our series of podcasts will, however, touch on a few important tax areas to be aware of, so stay tuned. But at the moment, and in my perspective, the biggest challenge with e-commerce transaction is the actual interaction between the taxation and the contract law. In the absence of overriding statutory provisions, common law principles of contract law applies to e-commerce contracts, which is the whole offer, acceptance, and considerations for all those that know a bit more about this. However, the current law did not really evolve in the digital environment, and issues may arise as to when and where a contract arises, which may have complex and quite serious tax implications. For example, the timing of a contract may be important for tax purposes because it affects things like when income is derived, when deductions are incurred, the date of ownership from which an asset is depreciated, or things like the value of trading stock and how we account for foreign exchange, and the timing of any GST liabilities or capital gain tax events. That's becoming an even more so important area as to the idea of when a customer accepts a contract with an e-commerce business. On this matter, the Commonwealth Electronic Transaction Act and its state counterparts, which defined when an electronic communication is dispatched and received, allows any Australian to give information, provide a signature, produce a document, and even retain information electronically. And it applies to all the laws of the Commonwealth, unless specifically exempt. In practice, the area has been defined as grey with limited global uniformity. However, Australia is currently considering acceding to the United Nations Convention on the Use of Electronic Communication, and that's really an area to watch. I'm pretty sure, Laura, you would have sometimes double-guessed yourself as to whether you can sign something digitally or retain records digitally.
Every day with tax returns and things like that.
Yeah, you never know. I went to Bunnings the other day. They refused my electronic receipt as a proof of purchase. So you never know. Another area of contract law and the interaction with the taxation law is really the place in which a contract is made. And it's most important for tax purposes because it may affect the jurisdiction in which stamp duty arises, whether in Australia or overseas. But within Australia, that may affect things like stamp duty and any other, you know, state-based taxes. Determination of the source of income from performance of the contract and the legal and tax consequences of the contract really depends on the location of where the contract has been entered into. The next question surrounding e-commerce contracts becomes, who are the parties really entering into a contract? There's no real requirement at this stage to identify the physical owner or controller of a website. So good care needs to be taken in doing so, and currently the legislation is evolving around this, both in Australia and internationally. And in many cases, it may be difficult or sometimes impossible to identify the taxable entity associated with an internet site. There are no requirements to identify the physical owner or controller of the site, and in the absence of such regulation, the anonymity of site owners may mean that income simply cannot be traced by our tax authorities. And that's being an area, again, of focus by the tax office. And in its electronic commerce project, the tax office recommended a few things. One was that businesses were to be required to include in their tax returns details of the relevant email addresses, the address of the website they're operating. The other one was to include a notification as to whether sales or goods or services were made on the internet. Now, only this one's been implemented. All of us completing tax return from this financial year onwards are required to disclose that. However, really, those measures would not impact on persons outside Australia who do not lodge returns with our Australian tax office. So businesses will see significant changes in this area in the next, I wouldn't even say 12 months. And really, that's when they need to consult with experts. You will find on the Digital Economy Hub a set of recommendations that have been made by William Buck in regards to how to deal with the e-commerce economy and how to make sure that we avoid all tax ramifications and enforceability of those e-commerce contracts.
Thanks so much, Eric. I think that was really informative, but I think it's really a space to watch. Keep an eye on the Digital Hub going forward for more podcasts, as Eric suggested, and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you, guys.